1925, he asked his board of directors to establish a foreign department, and they turned him down. So in 1926, he just went ahead and did it anyway, because he knew that the future of Coca-Cola lay outside the United States and lay with getting the rest of the world to try it. Next slide. Here's the letter I referenced earlier. I hope everybody can see it well enough. This letter is from 1911 in November, and it was written to the Coca-Cola Bottling Association, and this is describing setting up the bottling operations in the Philippines. They didn't get them actually running in 1911. It took until the beginning of 1912 before it was first bottled. But down near the bottom of it, I didn't have time to highlight it on my slide, but you can see they spent $40,000 establishing this first Coca-Cola bottling operation. Next slide. I'm going to show you some pretty pictures. This is all Coke in the Philippines. The first couple are from the 1912 time period. You can see in there, Pirate's Root here, Coca-Cola, and you see the Spanish sign. This is from a fair that was set up in 1912. People are taking pictures. I'll leave that one up for a second. And through the PR department, we can actually get any of these images for you that you want as well. Next slide. I love this one. These are the Howard sisters who were at the Clark Soda Fountain Lounge that they had set up. And notice that beautiful syrup urn on the left-hand side of the picture, that's that same one that was distributed in the United States and beginning in 1896. So as early as 1912, items were traveling to the Philippines. Next one. This one's great. Note that Wrigley Gum is in there as well. So you have Coca-Cola, Wrigley Gum, and American Lemonade, whatever American Lemonade is, I'm not quite sure. Next slide. We're jumping ahead a couple of decades. Now by 1927, San Miguel becomes the bottler of Coca-Cola. So once again, you see the San Miguel sign, and on the far right on that picture, you see the Coca-Cola sign. So we're all the way up into 1927 now. Next slide. Delivery was a little bit different in the 1920s. It was done by horse and buggy, and it's a little bit difficult to see, but you can see the San Miguel markings on the crate one of the ones in the middle. So that photo is from about 1928 or so. Next slide. This ad is from 1927. It was one of the early ones with San Miguel showing advertising to the Filipino population. Next slide. I love this one. I told Adele, I said, the Coca-Cola company has a history, we have a heritage of health. I've actually got a presentation I give in Atlanta called A Heritage of Health. Coke first sponsored the Red Cross in 1917. We've always, whatever community we work in, we've always worked to make that community a sustainable one. So this is actually from a program of the premiere of Gone with the Wind from 1939. And as you can see, all of the sales from the Coca-Cola went to the Chaplain's Aid Society. As part of a donation. So even then, we were giving away, or giving back to our communities in a meaningful way. The next slide. And Santa Claus, it's October, so it's already Christmas, and you've got to have St. Nick. I didn't have time. Last night I was going to do the Christmas trucks are coming to put that into the deck, because I know in certain parts of the world, and in the Philippines, the Christmas trucks are such an important part. Now it's almost the beginning of the Christmas season. The next slide. Robert Woodruff was known for iconic advertising. The pause that refreshes was his slogan. The Coca-Cola Santa Claus, the big beautiful images, and very few words, but this very evocative, emotional advertising. Next one. Robert Woodruff also associated the Coca-Cola company with the Olympic Games as early as 1928. Woodruff knew that wherever the world was gathering, Coca-Cola should be present. So he authorized the company to make the expenditure to visit the Olympic Games in Amsterdam in 1928. And we've been at every single Olympic Games since then. Next slide. 1931, when you see the exhibit next door, I'm going to give away one item. Every year, let me rephrase this as a story. Every year about November, December, my phone rings and it's the media asking if Coca-Cola invented Santa Claus. Easy answer is no, Coke didn't invent Santa Claus. He was around before us. But some cultures saw him as tall, some as short, some dressed him in green, some in brown. Thomas Nast drew him as this little dwarf-like creature. There was no image of Santa Claus. Santa was whatever that culture thought of Santa Claus. In 1931, we got the artist Haddon Sundblom, who was Swedish, to paint Santa Claus for us in advertising. Then we liked it so much, every year between 1931 and 1964, Sunbloom painted the Santa Claus. That Philippine ad that you saw from 1940, that was a rendering of a Sunbloom Santa. And by ubiquitous advertising around the world, we didn't invent Santa Claus, but we did create sort of the modern image of Santa Claus so that he wears red and white and he's jolly and friendly, just like your grandfather. Next image. This one I only put in here, we fought the word Coke for decades, and finally by 1942 we gave and we trademarked the word Coke as well as the word Coca-Cola, and we used the Sprite boy to advertise it. Next slide. This is an interesting story that has a role here in the Philippines as well. General Eisenhower in 1943 sent a telegram to the Coca-Cola company asking us to build 10 bottling plants in North Africa so that the troops would be able to get Coca-Cola to A, remind them of home, and B, so they wouldn't be drinking beer. Very practical reasons, you know, memories of home, nostalgia, and went into alcohol. We did better than that. We actually built 64 bottling plants at our own expense around the world, in Asia, in Europe, in North Africa, and we served over 5 billion bottles of Coca-Cola to the armed forces wherever they serve. Robert Woodruff said it very eloquently. He said every soldier in the field should get a Coke, regardless of what it costs the company, for a nickel, and we carry through on our promise. Next slide. This picture's from Okinawa, and it is showing one of the early efforts that we had in Asia. Next slide. Okay, I had a picture from the Philippines. It's a painting of the jungle dispenser, but I don't think it made this one. In 1950, Time magazine asked Robert Woodruff to be on the cover. At that time, Time typically had a caricature or a picture of a man that they were celebrating within that issue. The Man of the Year, or just Amelia Earhart, whatever it was, always a picture of a person. Robert Woodruff declined because he said the most important thing was the brand, not the person. And the Coke was more important than any single person that worked with Coke. So Time broke their tradition and for the first time ever put a brand on the cover of their magazine in the May issue. Next slide. The next thing is an interesting one, and that's the business environment that we wore today. And for over 50 years, we had a single product, a single package, and a single price. You had a 6.5 ounce Coke in a bottle or in a Bell Fountain glass, and it cost a nickel. After World War II, we broke the nickel code. But in 1955, we realized that the consumers around us were changing, and we had to change to meet what they wanted. So the company turned almost 180 degrees. Next slide. We introduced Fanta Orange, 1955. Next one. We introduced the king size and the family size Coke, the share Coke. Next slide. We changed our advertising agency. We went from Darcy, who we've been with since 1907, to McCann Erickson, who we stayed with for another 50 years. Next slide. We introduced the can. The consumers were telling us that they wanted the convenience of a portable package, so we had to produce one that met their needs. Next slide. We bought the Minute Maid company. I don't know if many of you know it, but Coca-Cola is actually the largest juice company in the world, the largest isotonic sport drink company in the world, the largest carbonated soft drink company in the world, and one of the largest bottle manufacturers, black water manufacturers in the world. And it all began in 1961 when we bought Minute Maid. We introduced Sprite in 1961. Next slide. Tab is not available in your market, but it's significant because it was our first diet drink. We realized that there was a growing community of consumers that wanted to avoid calories, so we developed a drink to meet that need. Next slide. So Coke has been in the diet business for more than 50 years. It's amazing. In 1971, we made one of the world's most famous television commercials, the famous Hilltop ad. This is the I'd Like to Buy the World a Coke ad. I'm actually going to play a clip of it for you. I've asked this a couple times in the Philippines, but apparently nobody likes Mad Men. Okay, well, when Mad Men aired its final episode, they approached Coke about a year ago to see if we would supply this ad. So after much back and forth, we agreed to supply the ad. So next slide. Can you click? Take a sip. That ad's been consistently voted in the top 10 of all ads, and one of the best ads ever made. And when Matt Weiner decided he wanted to end Mad Men, 3 years ago he decided he was going to end it with that ad. So it's exciting to have that happen. Next slide. 1977, we formed our first ever relationship between a global sports governing body and a company when the Coca-Cola company signed with FIFA.
It's 1 o'clock.
It is 1 o'clock. we've been working with FIFA on advertising since 1950, but we were anxious to have our youth soccer leagues around the world gain more prestige. So by joining with FIFA, our youth soccer leagues that were in almost every continent gained in stature. So it was a great relationship between us. Next slide. 1979, in the Philippines, this slide is going to resonate, but in America, the Mean Joe Green, the famous ad, came out. And it was interesting, too, because it was one of the first ads where the racial tension between this African-American football player and this little kid got resolved in the only way it could with Coca-Cola, in a little moment of happiness when the football player gives his jersey to the kid. Next up. We introduced Diet Coke in 1982. It's interesting, our legal department had fought for the name Diet Coke, saying that we were going to be confusing the consumers by having two products with the same name. But we finally broke through that barrier and introduced Diet Coke in 1982, and it quickly became the best-selling low-calorie drink, low-calorie cola in the world. Next slide. Then we made a mistake, New Coke. The one that yesterday at the business school that every single kid nodded their head when asked if they knew about New Coke. After 99 years of the great taste of Coca-Cola, Pepsi was gaining market share on us. They were never going to catch us, but they were gaining, and that terrified the senior management. So they actually changed the flavor of Coca-Cola on April 23rd, 1985, and it was tumult. People were protesting in the streets. The nightly news broke into the news broadcast to announce the news. People sued us. I grew up in Atlanta at this time, and I remember my dad calling me, telling me to go fill up the car with Coca-Cola. So I went to the local store, and I bought as much as I could, and we took it home to put it in a garage. 79 days later, the company came to its senses and reintroduced Coke Classic in the United States, and we've never made that mistake since. But what it taught us was an important lesson. We don't own the brand. Our consumers own the brand. When we thought that we owned it and we could do anything we wanted to, they quickly told us that we could. So we've remained true to brand Coke since then. Next one. Cherry Coke, my favorite drink. This is what I grew up with. You'd get a shot of cherry in your Coca-Cola. It was absolutely delicious. And it's one of the best-selling brands. Warren Buffett, the investor, brings five of them a day. Next slide. Coke went into space in 1985. We had the space can, and a few short years later, we had the space dispenser, so astronauts could get to enjoy their favorite drink, regardless of where they were. Next slide. 1993, we introduced the Always campaign and the famous polar bears who are still known around the world. Next slide. And then new markets. What's interesting from a business standpoint is if you look at the bottom of these, since the new markets began to open in 1978, almost half the world's population is just now becoming available to Coca-Cola in the past 30 years. It's an amazing thing when you consider China, Russia, India, the markets that are opening up to Coca-Cola now. Coke is in every country in the world except for two. Anybody want to take a guess at what two? At that table, we just talked about it, so you can't answer. North Korea and Cuba are the only two markets in the world where Coca-Cola is not bottled and sold. And both because we can't, because of government reasons. Next slide. Remind me never to do a deck that has bills, because it doesn't look like you're working. A growing portfolio. Coke has over, I don't know, tell me, is it like 800? I don't know the total number of brands and flavors anymore. The number keeps growing. We have thousands, over 800 brands and over 1,200 flavors around the world, and every different market has a different variety. And all of those include low-calorie, no-calorie, water, isotonic, milk, tea, coffee. We have a drink for every occasion, every desire that you could have at any given moment. Next slide. Innovation and sustainability. You don't have it in the Philippines yet, but the freestyle fountain dispenser is fascinating. It was based on technology from Dean Kamen, the guy that invented the Segway. It's called the microburst technology. And we, in turn, license that, and we are helping him with the slingshot technology, where he's doing water purification in Africa. So we're building eco centers across Africa and parts of Asia and Vietnam as well. to make water available to people who don't have access to water, which